is stripped away, and I simply come. Longing just to bring something that's of worth, that will bless your heart. I'll bring you more than a song, for a song in itself is not what you have required. You search much deeper within, through the way things appear. You're looking into my heart. I'm coming back to the heart of worship, and it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the thing I've made it. When it's all about you, it's all about you, Jesus.
Every single breath, I'll bring you more than a song, for a song in itself is not what you have required. You search much deeper within, through the way things appear. You're looking into my heart. It's all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the thing I made. When it's all about you, it's all about you, Jesus. I'm coming back to the heart of worship, 'cause it's all about you, it's all about you. I'm sorry, Lord, for the thing I've made it, 'cause it's all about you, it's all about you, Jesus. All about you.
How are you?
My daughter. Went somewhere to get a pen.
I'll bring you more than a song. I'll bring you more than a song. More than a song. I'll bring you more.
Well, good morning. It is good to see you all this morning. We're so glad that you're here to worship with us. No better way, as I told the early service, no better way to start out the week than in God's house to worship Him and give Him praise. We're going to do just that this morning. If you will, stand with us as we open up in singing.
Sing to the King who is coming to reign. Glory to Jesus, the Lamb that was slain. Life and salvation His empire shall bring, and joy to the nations. nations when Jesus is King. Oh, sing to the King who is coming to reign. Glory to Jesus, the Lamb that was slain. Life and salvation His empire shall bring, and joy to the nations when Jesus is King. Come, let us sing a song declaring we belong to Jesus. Oh, He is all we need. So lift up a heart of praise. Sing now with voices raised to Jesus. Sing to the King. And for His returning, we watch and we pray. We will be ready the dawn of that day, and we'll join in singing with all the redeemed. 'Cause Satan is vanquished and Jesus is King.
Church, come, let us sing.
Oh, and come, let us sing a song declaring we belong to Jesus. He is all we need. And lift up a heart of praise. Sing now with voices raised to Jesus. Sing to the King. Oh, and come, let us sing a song declaring we belong to Jesus. For He is all we need. And lift up a heart of praise. Sing now with voices raised to Jesus. Sing to the King. Sing to the King. Sing to the King. Sing to the King.
Well, we're here today to do that. Sing to King Jesus. He's the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, and He's worthy of our praise and our worship. If you know Him as your Savior, you have every reason to sing to the King this morning. I hope you're here to do that. So good to see you. If you have not already filled out your information card, we ask that everybody do that. Fill it out. And then when you leave at the end of the service, just place it along with your tithes and offerings in the offering drop boxes that are at the back of the sanctuary. We're going to have a great time today celebrating Jesus, worshiping Him, looking at His Word together, see what's in store in the days ahead, and so we're glad you're here to be a part of it. Let me lead us in prayer this morning. Oh, Father God, as we come before You, we do come to sing to King Jesus, for there's no one like You, the Redeemer, the Savior, the Sustainer, our hope, our future, our life. So we worship You today. We seek to live for You every day as we worship and honor You in all that we do. Father, we pray for our world. We know this world's in a mess without You. And so we seek to be Your light and Your salt in our world so that people come to know You. We pray for revival in America. We pray for our president and our representatives and our senators, Father. We pray that Your Holy Spirit would come upon them, Your Word would convict them, and we'd be drawn, all be drawn, to Your truth, because we know that in serving You and honoring You and representing You is where life is found. The greatest abundance, the trueness of life is found in You. So we seek to do that. We pray for that. We seek it. And now, Father God, as we focus upon You, You're our worship, You're our audience today. May we honor You. In Your name we pray. Amen.
Oh, soon and very soon, we are going to see the King. Soon and very soon, we are going to see the King. Soon and very soon, we are going to see the King. Hallelujah, hallelujah, we're going to see the King. Oh, no more crying there, we are going to see the King. No more crying there, we are going to see the King. No more crying there, we are going to see the King. Hallelujah, hallelujah, we're going to see the King. And no more dying there, we are going to see the King. No more dying there, we are going to see the King. And no more dying there, we are going to see the King. Hallelujah, hallelujah, we're going to see the King. There's a land that is fairer than day, and by faith I can see it afar. For the Father waits over the way to prepare us a dwelling place there. In the sweet by and by, we shall meet on that beautiful shore. In the sweet by and by, we shall meet on that beautiful shore. To our bountiful Father above, we will offer our tribute of praise for the glorious gift of His love and the blessings that hallow our days. In the sweet by and by, we shall meet on that beautiful shore. In the sweet by and by, we shall meet on that beautiful shore. In the sweet by and by, we shall meet on that beautiful for sure. In the sweet by and by, we shall meet on that beautiful shore. I believe in Christ, risen from the dead. He now reigns victorious, His kingdom knows no end. Through His resurrection, death has lost its hold. I know on that final day, I'll rise as Jesus rose. On that day, we will see you shining brighter than the sun. On that day, we will know you as we lift our voice as one. Till that day, we will praise you for your never-ending grace.
and we will keep on singing on that glorious day. And what a blessed hope, though now tired and worn, we will spend eternity around our Savior's throne. And though we grieve our losses, we grieve not in vain, for we know our crown of glory waits beyond the grave on that day. We will see you shining brighter than the sun on that day. We will know you as we lift our voice as one. Till that day we will praise you for your never-ending grace. And we will keep on singing on that glorious day.
You're looking forward to that day, church? Amen. Let's sing it together. Hallelujah. What a day it'll be. Let's sing.
And hallelujah, what a day it will be. For at home with you, my joy is complete. And as I run into your arms open wide, I will see my Father who is waiting for me. And hallelujah, what a day it will be. For at home with you, my joy is complete. And as I run into your arms open wide, I will see my Father who is waiting for me. My Father who is waiting for me. On that day we will see you shining brighter than the sun. On that day we will know you as we lift our voice as one. Till that day we will praise you for your never-ending grace. And we will keep on singing on that glorious day.
Sing it, church.
Oh, on that day we will see you shining brighter than the sun. On that day we will know you as we lift our voice as one. Till that day we will praise you for your never-ending grace. We will keep on singing on that glorious day. And we will keep on singing on that glorious day.
Heavenly Father God, Father, we praise you. Father, we thank you. We know you are still in control. Father, even though we may see things coming apart around us, Father, we don't have to worry, we don't have to fret, we don't have to fear, because you are in control of it all. Father, we thank you. As your children, you are preparing a place for us, and we can look forward to the day when you come again. Father, may we live each day in the anticipation and expectation of your coming. It's in your precious, holy name we pray. Amen. You may be seated.
Take your Bible, turn with me to 1 Corinthians. 1 Corinthians chapter 3. Take also your sermon insert. We're talking about Heaven's Awards Day. Are you looking forward to Heaven's Awards Day? And our focal passage is in 1 Corinthians chapter 3, and I want to begin reading in verse 4. So listen as I read this portion of God's Word. Many others that we'll be looking at are on your outline, but the focus is 1 Corinthians chapter 3, beginning in verse 4. The scripture says this: For when one says, I follow Paul, and another, I follow Apollos, are you not mere men, or are you not being worldly? For what, after all, is Apollos? And what is Paul? only servants through whom you came to believe, as the Lord has assigned to each his task. I planted the seed, Apollos watered it, but God made it grow. So neither he who plants nor he who waters is anything, but only God, who makes things grow. The man who plants and the man who waters have one purpose, and each will be rewarded according to his own labor. For we are God's fellow workers. You are God's field, God's building. By the grace that God has given me, I laid a foundation as an expert builder, and someone else is building on it. But each one should be careful how he builds. For no one can lay any other foundation than the one that has already been laid, which is Jesus Christ. If any man builds on this foundation, using gold, silver, costly stone, wood, hay, or straw, his work will be shown for what it is, because the day will bring it to light. It will be revealed with fire, and the fire will test the quality of each man's work. If what he has built survives, he will receive his reward. If it is burned up, he will suffer loss. He himself will be saved, but only as one escaping through the flames. You know, there are a lot of awards days. Most schools toward the end of their school year will have an awards day. They will give out awards for different things. Some schools have valedictorians. Some schools have an award for the most likely to succeed, the funniest, the most helpful, the best looking, the most athletic. Some schools give out perfect attendance awards. If you just show up, you get an award. Some schools now have cut out the valedictorian award because they are concerned that because one person gets recognized for excellent grades, they'll make the ones that didn't make good grades feel bad. But that kind of a school is supposed to be about helping people learn, right? And grow in their knowledge and understanding. And then there are sports clubs. Sports clubs a lot of times give out simply participation awards. Again, if you get a trophy just to the one that won, it makes the ones that didn't win feel bad. So a lot of things just have participation awards. Hollywood has their awards day. They give out awards for the best film, best actress, best supporting actress, best one that was there. They give out all these awards, and it goes on and on and on their night. Beauty pageants have their awards for the most beautiful or the one with the most poise. There are a lot of different awards and awards days. But the Bible talks about the award day of all days. It's heaven's awards day. It's on God's calendar. We're looking in this series of last day's events or occurrences and things that will happen. On God's calendar, there is heaven's awards day. It's the most important one. The recognitions, the awards given out will be not like typical the world gives out, but how heaven awards on that day is so very important. And if you're a Christian, you should be very, very interested. So let's talk about it this morning. Are you ready? Are you prepared for heaven's rewards day? Number one, a Christian's life will be evaluated and rewarded by God. A Christian's life will be evaluated and rewarded by God. A lot of times Christians say, well, we won't be part of the judgment of God or the evaluation of God. And that's true in the sense that we will not be evaluated as to whether we'll get into heaven or not, whether we're saved or not. That's already determined when a person believes upon Jesus Christ. There will be a judgment, the great white throne judgment seat of Christ, that we'll talk about a little more detail about for unbelievers and giving them their punishment for their rejection of Christ. But there's also talked about this heaven's awards day for Christians, where Christians are rewarded for the various things concerning their life. The Bible talks about this. We just read it in 1 Corinthians 3, verse 8. It says, each one will be rewarded according to his own labor. So each Christian will be rewarded. It's a very individual thing. But each Christian will be evaluated his life, and he will be rewarded. Now, the Bible talks about a Christian's life in different ways. In this passage that we read in 1 Corinthians 13, Apostle Paul said, for a Christian's life is like a building. He said, there's one foundation. That foundation is Jesus Christ. And if a Christian life is built, it is built upon Jesus. If you're trying to build on something other than Jesus, you don't have the Christian life. He said, so our lives as Christians are built upon Jesus Christ. But every Christian is then to build his life according to the purposes of God for him. And the lives may look a little different, but they're all to be built. And so he gives an example of the Christian life as a building. He said some people will build their life out of wood. Some people will build their life out of straw, mud, just worthless things that will fall apart and rot and decay. But other Christians will build their life out of precious stones, valuable things. And those are the lives that stand. And so he says that life, that build, how you build your Christian life, one day on Heaven's Awards Day will be evaluated and rewarded. Many passages of Scripture speak of this. Psalm 58, verse 11 says, then the people will say, surely the righteous are rewarded. Surely there is a God who judges the earth. And surely the righteous will be rewarded. There's a Heaven's Awards Day. And then in Matthew chapter 5, verse 11, it says, blessed are you when people insult you, persecute you, and falsely say all kinds of evil against you because of me. Rejoice and be glad, because great is your reward in heaven. It says there's an awards day when you will be rewarded. And then also in Revelation 22, verse 12, Jesus said, look, I'm coming soon, and my reward is with me, and I will give to each person according to what he's done. So Heaven's Awards Day is coming. It's a time when the life of Christians will be evaluated and awarded. Now let's talk about a little bit more. Let's talk about the areas of a Christian's life that will be evaluated. So in your outline it says Scripture speaks of different areas of a Christian's life that will be evaluated for rewards. Now, God will evaluate our life differently than the way many things are evaluated on this earth or rewarded on this earth. So let's talk about various areas that the Bible says will be evaluated of a Christian's life. First of all, his actions. His actions. All of these are going to begin with the letter A, hopefully to help you remember them. But our actions will be evaluated. 1 Corinthians 3, verse 8. And they will each be rewarded according to their own labor or their own actions, the things that they have done. So our actions will be evaluated. My actions of obedience will be evaluated and rewarded. The Bible says it is required of a servant to be faithful, to be obedient to God. And so my obedience to God will be evaluated, how I've obeyed Him, how I've followed Him, my actions. Also in relation to that, or our words, our things we say. Those are part of our actions, how we talk, what we talk about. Matthew chapter 12, verse 16, Jesus said, but I tell you that everyone will have to give an account on the day of judgment for every empty word they have spoken. Are your words empty? Are they vain? The Bible says we're to use our words to lift up, not to put down. We're to build, not to destroy with our words. So how, you know, the Bible says that a person's words are so powerful. They're like a burning fire that can destroy. James says, so be careful about your words. No wonder the writer of the book of the Psalms says, oh God, put a watch over my mouth. May my words be active things to help and encourage and build up and edify rather than to condemn and to destroy. So our actions, whether it's in our words or things we do or things we don't do, will be evaluated by God, and they will be rewarded. And then also, number two, our attitudes. Our attitudes. You know, a lot of times we think, well, nobody can see my attitudes, but God can. So our attitudes are our motives for what we do and why we do things. They will be evaluated. In Philippians chapter 2, verse 3, it says this: do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit, but rather in humility value others above yourselves, not looking to your own interests, but also to the interests of others. In your relationships with one another, have the same attitude as Christ Jesus, who being in the very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be held on to or to be used for his own advantage. See, Christ had this attitude. And what was his attitude? His attitude was of humility and service. You know, Jesus said, I've come not to be served, but to serve. And so in everything he did, it was covered by this attitude of service and humility. Unfortunately, many times Christians have some poor attitudes. The reason they do things is not a good reason. I mean, and even when they do things, sometimes we decide like we're mad at the world or we're carrying this heavy burden. We're going around pouting, you know, but the Bible says in the Psalms, serve the Lord with gladness. Not in sadness or madness or anger or you know, whatever. We have this attitude of service unto God, a willingness to please him. You know, sometimes people in church, they'll come up and just say, preacher, what can I do to help? How can I be a help? That's the attitude of service. That's an attitude of giving that God says will be evaluated and rewarded. That's the attitude we should have as the people of God, the attitude of Christ. And then number three, also on the inside of your outline, not only will our actions and our attitudes, but our attention seeking will be evaluated. Our attention seeking. Do I seek attention in the things that I do? Do I preach to get attention? Do I preach to get applause? Do you in your service to God, do you do it for attention? The Bible says this will be evaluated on why we're doing what we're doing, not just the attitude with which we do what we do, but why are we doing it? Are we doing it just to get applause or attention of man? The Bible says in Matthew 6, verse 1, be careful not to practice your righteousness in front of others to be seen by them. If you do, you'll have no reward in heaven. You may get something here, but it's not going to be from me. Maybe from others, maybe attention from others, but that's all it. That's it. So even in serving God, if you're doing it to get attention, to draw attention, you look and have people say, oh man, look at brother, boy, isn't he something, boy? Isn't he doing, you know, isn't he doing, and just praise, you know? Said, no, no. Don't do things for attention. Now, we can get praise for things, and that's fine. We should praise people when they do good things and when they serve God. But I'm not to do it for attention. You're not to do it for attention. You're not to do it for the praise of people. We do it for God. And hopefully we bring thanksgiving from people also in that which is done for him. But our purpose is not for attention. And then, number four, our abilities. Our abilities. We'll be judged, evaluated, rewarded on our abilities that we have. Luke chapter 12, verse 48 says, for everyone who's been given much, much will be demanded. And for the one who's been entrusted with much, even much more will be asked. See, different people are given different abilities. You know, we say that we're all shaped for ministry as believers. We're shaped for service. Our shape stands for our spiritual gift. The H stands for our heart. The A stands for our natural abilities. The P stands for our personality. The E stands for our experiences. We have all of those different things that go into making up our life. And how we use those things are to be for God and for his glory. And that will be evaluated by God, by our abilities, how we're made. Now, you will not be evaluated for what you cannot do. You'll be evaluated for what you can do. And the truth is, many of us can do much more for God than we're doing, but we're choosing not to do it. It's not because we can't do it, but we can, but we don't. So we'll be evaluated for the abilities we're given and how we use our abilities. Now think about it. Many people are given many different abilities. Some people are given musical abilities. They use them maybe to sing secular songs, but they don't use them to sing songs of honor and worship to God. Some people are given talents of playing instruments or teaching. They use those abilities in the secular sense, but they don't use them for God. Some people have abilities of caring and ministry and service, gardening or whatever. They use them a lot of ways or on themselves, but they don't use them for God. We'll be evaluated on how we use our abilities for God, to honor Him. So what do you have? How are you using it? You'll be evaluated not what you can't do, but what you can do. How you use those things and what you didn't do with what you had. And then number five, your afflictions. You know, you'll be evaluated on your afflictions. Some people say, well, I have a lot of evaluating going on because I got a lot of afflictions. You know, in Psalm 119, the psalmist said, I thank God, I'm paraphrasing, I thank God for my afflictions. He said, for if it was not for my afflictions, I would not have known how to follow God. And he says in another place, he says, I would not have learned of God. Through our afflictions, many times we learn to trust God, to depend upon God. That was in Psalm 119 where the psalmist says, I'm even thankful for my afflictions. But the Bible says what we do with our afflictions, how we handle our afflictions, the difficulties that come in our life, and especially the afflictions associated with serving Christ, how we handle those afflictions will be evaluated and will be rewarded. Hebrews chapter 11, you know, is that chapter many times we call the Hall of Fame of Faith. This chapter that talks about men and women of great faith in God, some of the things they went through, some of the things they endured, how they dealt with those. And in Hebrews chapter 11, verse 25, it talks about Moses. And it says, Moses chose to be mistreated along with the people of God rather than to enjoy the fleeting pleasures of sin. For he regarded disgrace for the sake of Christ as of greater value than the treasures of Egypt, because he was looking ahead to his reward. Said Moses went through some things while he was in Egypt, some afflictions, some difficulties, because he says, you know what? I don't want to receive these things that are just going to be temporal and are not going to last, but I want to receive the things of eternity, the things of God. He said, so he endured those things because he was looking ahead to his reward in heaven. Do you know that there are pleasures in sin? That's what that passage says. It says there are pleasures in sin, but they're only for a season. But the eternal rewards of God are eternal rewards. They last, and they last. So how do you handle the afflictions? And then in Matthew chapter 5, verse 11, Jesus said, blessed are you when people insult you, persecute you, and falsely say all kinds of evil against you because of me. Now, a lot of times people will insult you, but they're insulting you because you deserve to be insulted. You're insulting, you know. So he's talking about those that are because of Christ. He said, rejoice and be glad because great is your reward in heaven. It says God evaluates how we are afflicted, how we dealt with persecution and hardships because of Christ, and we'll be rewarded in how we did that. So the Scripture talks about different areas. Those are just some. There are many areas that the Scripture talks about that will be evaluated and rewarded. Now, number three, the Scripture speaks of different kinds of rewards that a Christian will receive. There are different kinds of rewards. We said that heaven has an awards day. There are various bases of evaluation of our life as a Christian, but what are the rewards? Well, there are many, many rewards that the Scripture speaks of, but let's just talk about a few different kinds of rewards. Number one, there are crowns. The Bible says that Christians can receive crowns as rewards. Some people say, well, are these literal crowns? Well, I don't know, but I do know this. I want them. I want a head full of them. Whatever they are, however they are, the Bible says God gives them and they're good. and they're honoring to him. So I want a head full of them. I hope you do also. Let's talk about some of the crowns that the scripture talks about. It talks about what I'm calling a crown of discipline or a crown of perseverance. In 1 Corinthians 9, verse 24, it says, "Do you not know that in a race all the runners run, but only one gets the prize? Run in such a way as to get the prize. Everyone who competes in the games goes into strict training. They do it to get a crown that will not last, but we do it to get a crown that will last forever." In the Living Bible of that 1 Corinthians 9, 24, it says, "Train to get first prize, and you must deny yourself in many things." In training to get the first prize, you must deny yourself in many ways. See, there's a crown of discipline. There's a crown of perseverance that you must train yourself to get. And it requires discipline. It requires, this crown requires denying of self. It's not just in coasting through the Christian life. It's not just being lazy through the Christian life that you receive this crown of discipline or the crown of perseverance, but it comes through much struggle. And I'm afraid many Christians will not get this crown, the crown of discipline. Why? Because they live such undisciplined lives. There's such undisciplined lives in regards to their Christian life. They struggle to get up on the simplest of things on Sunday morning and come to worship. Why? Because they stayed out all Saturday night. You know, if you spend out most Saturday night staying out late, it's going to affect your Sunday morning. It's going to affect your energy. It's going to affect your focus. It's going to affect your worship. On Sunday morning, if Jesus is your all in all and it's worshiping him, why do you do things that directly impact your worship of him? People are, we just don't discipline our lives. Some people say, well, you know, I just don't know as much about God as some Christians seem to know. And I just don't sense his presence. I just don't see his working in my life as, you know, it's taking place in other Christians. You know, why is that? And as they talk about it, they say, well, you know, I just don't have the time to put in that, you know, other Christians seem like they have all this extra time that they can study God's word, that they can be used of him and give themselves to you. But it seems like these same people have plenty of time to hang out with friends. Seem like they have plenty of time to go to movies and watch TV. Not that those things are bad, but I saw somewhere that the average person spends about 5 hours a day on their phone. Plenty of time for that. Don't tell me you're reading the Bible app, are you? But, you know, we're just not disciplined. So there's a crown of discipline. There's a crown of perseverance for those that will daily deny themselves, take up their cross, and follow Jesus. And then there is a crown of soul winning. A crown of soul winning. 1 Thessalonians 2, verse 19, Apostle Paul said, "For what is our hope, our joy, or the crown in which we will glory in the presence of our Lord Jesus when he comes?" It's you. Paul says to the Thessalonians, you're our crown of soul winning. They had led them to know the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, some translations call this the crown of rejoicing, because Paul says, man, I rejoice. I'm going to rejoice in the presence of God because y'all are here. How much rejoicing are you going to be doing in heaven because you're looking around, there are going to be people you led to the Lord? Now, yes, it's of God, but God uses us. So how much rejoicing is there going to be in heaven when you look around and say, okay, who did I bring with me? It's a crown of soul winning. The crown of rejoicing. In Psalm 126, verse 5, it says, "We shall come rejoicing, bringing in the sheaves of the harvest of the saints. The fields are ripe unto the harvest. How many sheaves are you bringing with you and rejoicing as you come before God?" So there's a crown of soul winning. You're going to be wearing a crown? Going to have one jewel in it? You know, just thinking about this, thinking, well, you know, what if every I said, what if every person in this church, what if, say, if every Christian in this church leads one person to the Lord in the next year, what effect will that have on our church? It'll make an impact, won't it? Just think about the people that'll be on the way to heaven instead of on the way to hell, because each one led one to the Lord. Yes, it's of God, but he uses us. So there's a crown of rejoicing, the crown of soul winning. And then C, there's a crown of righteousness, a crown of righteousness, 2 Timothy 4, verse 8. Now there is in store for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will award me on that day, and not only to me, but also to those who have longed for his appearing. It's a crown of righteousness. It says one characteristic of these people is that they long for the appearing of Christ. You know, we talked about how as Christians we look for the appearing of Christ. We long for the appearing of Christ. We love the appearing of Christ. But there's also, we live for the appearing of Christ. I've asked this before. Let me ask it again. We're in this series. We talk about the last days. We're singing about Jesus coming again. He's preparing a place for you. What difference does the coming of Jesus Christ, the fact of his coming, what difference is it making in the way you're living? And if most Christians are honest, they'll say it makes no difference. Not because they're living at this high level, but because they're living at such a low level and they're continuing to live in the things of the world rather than the things of God. They're earthly focused rather than godly focused. But when a person is looking for, longing for, and living for the return of Christ, he's going to have a crown of righteousness. His life is characterized by a life that is in view of the return. So this is the crown of righteousness. And then D, the crown of life, the crown of life. James chapter 1, verse 12, happy is the man who does not give in and do wrong when he's tempted, for afterwards he will get as his reward the crown of life that God has promised those who love him, the crown of life. He's been tempted, but he stays strong. He still stands. That doesn't mean you never fall. The Bible says, though a righteous man falls seven times, he rises again. And this is called the crown of life. Some people think there are different reasons for this, but it seems to indicate that when you live a life unto God, there is a life you experience. Jesus said, you know, the thief comes to steal, to kill, and destroy, but I've come that you may have life and to its fullest or to its abundance. There's a crown that we'll experience of abundance as we don't give in to temptation. We stand strong, put on the full armor of God, as it says in Ephesians. We stand strong in the things of God and the armor of God so that we resist temptation and against him. So there's a crown of life. And then E, the crown of glory. The crown of glory. 1 Peter 5, verse 3, not lording it over those entrusted to you, but being examples to the flock. And when the chief shepherd appears, you will receive the crown of glory that will never fade away. This is the crown of glory. And some people refer to it as the crown of leadership, the crown of ministry. It says there's a crown, there's a reward that would be given to those who've been placed in authority over others. And how they lead those that they're in authority over will be evaluated. That involves ministers, that involves leaders of D-Life groups, facilitators, leaders of Bible study classes, Sunday school classes. I believe also involves in homes. Parents, you're in an authority over your children. You're to lead. They're not to lead you. You're to lead them. And how we lead in a godly way will be evaluated. And we'll be given this crown of glory in how we lead and represent God. So these are some of the crowns. They're kinds of rewards. One is crowns. Second kind of reward are clothes. Clothes. These all begin with the letter C. Last week, we were talking about that wedding of the Lamb, that great event on God's calendar, the wedding of the Lamb. And in Revelation 19, verse 8, we saw this picture of the bride. And how is the bride dressed? Well, fine linen, bright and clean, was given her to wear. The fine linen stands for the righteous acts of God's holy people. In other words, she will be dressed in these clothes in a certain way, and it has to do with how she's lived, how the bride has lived. You will be dressed for that wedding in a certain way. And we talked about a lot of time that. But one of the rewards is a crown, various kinds of crowns, and various kinds of clothes. And then third, there are rewards that are cities. Rewards that are cities. This may surprise some people, but in Luke chapter 19, verse 17, Jesus is telling this parable, this story, and he has given out various gifts or talents or responsibilities to different of his servants. One takes those and uses them wisely so that they multiply and are Christ-honoring or God-honoring. And it says, "Well done, my good servant," his master said, "because you've been trustworthy in a very small matter, take charge of 10 cities." He gave different cities a responsibility to different of their servants, depending on how much they had been given. Different ones were given different amounts, and they were evaluated on what they had done with what they'd given. And here is a reward of a city. A city. Now, some people say, well, like, are the crowns literal? Are the cities literal? Well, there are a lot of passages of Scripture that speak about how we will conduct ourselves, some things that we'll be doing during the millennial reign of Christ, and even in eternity. Let me just give you a couple of passages that I have. Here in Revelation chapter 5, verse 10, it says, "You have made them," this is that scene around the throne in Revelation chapter 4 and chapter 5, where we're gathered around the throne, the rapture has occurred, we're gathered around the throne, and it says, "You have made them to be a kingdom and priests to serve our God, and they will reign on earth." It's talking about those that have been blood-bought, the redeemed. It says they're going to reign on earth. What are they going to reign over? Are there going to be cities that they reign over? And then in Revelation 20, verse 4, just put this reference on your outline, but Revelation 20, verse 4 says, "And I saw thrones on which were seated those who had been given authority to judge." That's Revelation 20, verse 4. John said, "In this vision I had, I saw thrones," not just one throne that the Lamb sat on, but there were thrones, and on those thrones were people seated who had been given authority to rule and to reign. Kind of sounds like maybe cities. And then in 1 Corinthians 6, verse 2, I put this reference on your outline, it says, "Don't you know that Christians one day will judge and govern the world?" That's a scary thought to a lot of people. Christians will judge and govern the world, for we will reign with him. And so Jesus says, or the Scripture says, that as a reward, there will be some people who will receive cities over which they will rule. You say, "I don't know if I want to be a mayor. I don't know if I want to be a governor." If God gives it, you'll love it. You'll love what he gives as his rewards. So there are crowns, there are clothes, there are cities, and there's also Christ. Christ, God, is a reward himself. In Genesis 15, verse 1, this is way back at the very beginning. It says, "After this, the word of the Lord came to Abraham in a vision. Don't be afraid, Abram. I am your shield. I am your very great reward." God said, "I am your reward. Obey me. Trust me." Remember, he gave him a mission. Didn't make a whole lot of sense. Said, "Follow me. Go to this land I'm going to show you." And he said, "If you do, you'll find me that I'm your reward. I'm your reward." Christ is our reward. He's our all in all. So there are things that are evaluated. There are kinds of rewards that we receive. And then number four, if you haven't already got the idea, heaven will not be the same for everyone, because Christians will be rewarded different at heaven's rewards day. Heaven's not going to be the same. A lot of times people say, you know, heaven's going to be the same for everybody. You know, it's no different. And many times I've heard people even say this. I've heard people say something like this: "Well, I don't care about rewards. Just getting to heaven will be enough." If you say that, if you think that as a Christian, shame on you. I'm serious. Heaven's not going to be the same. Just like hell's not going to be the same. There are different punishments in hell. Heaven will not be the same. So don't think just getting to heaven will be enough. Look at how the Scripture speaks of this. In Revelation 3, verse 11, it says, Jesus said, I'm coming soon. Hold on to what you have so that no one will take your crown. Some people are going to lose their crown because of the way they lived. You think they're going to think the same? It's going to be the same for them in heaven. They lost a crown. I'm going to talk about why that's important. Or I put a couple more references on your outline. I put 1 John 2:28. In 1 John 2:28, it says, live so that you will be confident and unashamed when Christ returns. Live in such a way that when Christ returns, you're going to be confident. You're going to be confident. You'll hear his well done. And you're going to be unashamed in how you lived. Now, the flip side of that's also scary true. There are going to be some Christians that when Christ comes, they're going to be ashamed. They're going to be ashamed how they lived. They're going to be ashamed how they dirtied their garments. They're going to be ashamed how they lived for self rather than Christ. So heaven's not going to be the same. How about 1 Corinthians 3? We just read it in our focal passage, then about verse 14 to 15. It says, there will be some who built their Christian life on straw and wood, and when it's evaluated, it'll burn up. It'll be shown to be not worth nothing. This empty, vain. He said they'll suffer loss. And they'll be saved, oh yeah, but they'll smell like somebody that just came through the fire. You ever been out barbecuing and you came in the house and people go, whoo, you smell like smoke. Some people are going to be in heaven, they smell like smoke. They got everything they did got burned up. They made it to heaven. They'll say, well, just being to heaven is going to be enough. They'll have suffered loss. They'll be ashamed. If you're a believer, listen, if you're a believer and you're not ashamed of your failings for Christ, something's wrong. And there'll be those that come to heaven. They'll be ashamed. So, heaven will be different. And number five, so Christians should strive to be rewarded by God. Christians should strive to be rewarded by God. Sometimes you hear people say, well, I don't think we ought to seek after rewards. Well, you shouldn't be attention-seeking, but you should seek the rewards that come from being pleasing to God, being obedient to Him. We should seek rewards. We should strive to be rewarded. In Philippians chapter 3, Apostle Paul said, brothers and sisters, I do not consider myself yet to have taken hold of it, but this one thing I do, forgetting what is behind and straining toward what is ahead, I press on toward the goal to win the prize for which God has called me heavenward. He said, God's called me to heaven. He said, there are rewards, there are prizes awaiting. He said, this one thing I'm going to do, I'm going to put all my focus, all my energies in receiving those rewards because it honors God. So he said, I strain to it. I'm not just coasting. He said, I'm making my efforts. I'm denying self. I'm disciplining myself so that I am rewarded. So, Christians, yes, you should strive to be rewarded by God. And then number six, heaven's reward day is not here yet. So don't get discouraged. Heaven's rewards day, the awards day, is not here yet. So don't get discouraged. It's coming. Now, God does reward along the way. Just like last week we talked about, you know, how the Holy Spirit rewards us along the journey to our wedding of the Lamb, to meeting Christ. He rewards us with some good things to let us know that, yes, He's real. Yes, God's for us. Yes, God is with us. There are rewards along the way, but the big reward is coming. Well, heaven's awards day is not here yet. Don't get discouraged. You know, sometimes as Christians, we look around and we say, you know, it looks like unbelievers are getting rewarded more than we are. They're not trying to live for God. Many times they're trying not to live for God. They're deliberately being rebellious, God-hating, and it seems like they're benefiting. Which reminds me of something Johnny Carson, some of y'all don't even remember Johnny Carson, but a comedian from years and years ago. One time, a famous, well-known person had been caught in some awful, terrible sin, but then he benefited greatly from it. And Johnny Carson said, well, it looks like the wages of sin are above minimum. Sometimes it looks like that in our world today. It looks like evil is being rewarded. But listen, heaven's rewards day is not here yet. So don't get discouraged. I've heard the old story of the two farmers that lived side by side. One was a God-fearing, a God-believing, trusting man who prayed diligently over his farms and everything he did. And right beside him lived this openly arrogant, boastful atheist who did not believe God and who constantly ridiculed his farmer who believed in God. And at the planting season in the spring, the atheist said, "I tell you what, when we harvest our crops in October, I bet you I have just as good or not a bigger crop than you do. And I don't believe in God." So they both worked, they both tilled, they both planted. And when it came to October and they harvest, sure enough, the atheist had a bigger harvest than the God-believing farmer. He said, I produced more per acre in my fields than you with all your praying, all your supposedly God-honoring did in your fields. What do you have to say about this?" And the wise, godly farmer says, "God does not give all of his rewards on the October harvest day. There's coming a heavenly awards day. God gives some along the way, but the awards day of all awards day is coming. So don't be discouraged. You see evil prospering. You're seeing others seem like they're being rewarded for their evil doing. Don't be discouraged. The heaven's rewards day for the people of God is coming. And then number 7, remember the ultimate purpose of our rewards is to honor Christ. The ultimate purpose of our rewards is to honor Christ. It's not to honor ourselves so much as it is to honor Christ. It's not that we get rewards so that people in heaven will look around and say, "Wow, what, how great on earth. Or didn't we do a good job on earth?" It is to honor Christ. I mean, think about the rewards we get again. We get the crowns. We said there are various crowns. Look at Revelation 4, verse 10. It says, again, this is that scene when we get to heaven, when we're raptured, we get around the throne of God. Revelation 4 and Revelation 5, the 24 elders fall down before him who sits on the throne, and they worship him who lives forever and ever, and they lay their crowns before the throne and say, "You are worthy, O Lord our God, to receive glory and honor and power, for you created all things, and by your will they were created and have their being." So we even get our crown. Our crowns are to lay before Christ in honor of him. And says, it's all about you. How about our clothes? He said, we get clothes. What are the clothes for? Remember last Sunday, we said during the wedding of the Lamb, and the bride, the church, the redeemed, are dressed in the garments, pure and white. Or do they wear those garments? Does the bride wear the garment so the groom will say, "Boy, she certainly was good"? Or the people that are there, the guests, say, "Boy, she's dressed nice." Or so that we ourselves can say, "Boy, I'm dressed good." We wear them for the groom, for Christ. They're for his honor, for his well done, for his glory. How about our cities? Said, you get a reward of a city? Why do we rule it? We rule it for the honor of Christ. We rule it for the honor of God. So it's according to his ways. Those that have cities in the millennial, they're for the honor of Christ. You see, Christ himself. You see, the Christ himself is a reward. How do you wear Christ? You wear him so that Christ is seen in you. You remember in Genesis, you know, people say the whole Bible is kind of in Genesis, and then it's fulfilled as we get to the end in the Revelation, and that this is true. In Genesis chapter 1 and 2, we see the creation account. And remember in Genesis 1, it says that God created man in his own image. And then God told man to multiply and spread out over the whole earth. Now, why did God say that? Did God say that just because, you know, I just want a full earth? I want a lot of people running around on earth. It's more than that. God said, look, I'm creating you in my image so that when mankind spreads out all over, wherever you look on the earth, you'll see the image of God. See, it's for him, it's for his will and his purpose. So man was to multiply, man was to bring up his children in the nurture, the admonition of the Lord. So everywhere you look, you see the image of God, and God is glorified throughout the whole earth. But, you know, sin's messed that up. Sin's made a mockery of the image of God in our world today. I hope there's coming a day. There's coming a day we're going to wear Christ. The image of God will be so in us, we'll be on the earth, the new earth that God will create, and all through eternity, people look around and say, there's the image of God. There's the image of God. There's the image of God. All in His children, there's the image of God. See how God's purposes are brought to completion? So that God is honored in His creation. Sin thought to defeat us, but Christ overruled in the crucifixion, the resurrection, and His redemption. It's all for Christ. We don't seek them for ourselves. We seek them. Reason I want me a head full of crowns. Reason I want to be dressed in white. Reason I want to rule over cities. Reason I want Christ in me is so Christ is honored in my life. He is seen more clearly in me. How about you? Heaven's awards day is coming. It's on the way. Are you looking forward to it? Let's bow together as we pray. Father, we thank you for your word, the truth, the relevance of it. May we live not so focused on this earth that we fail to see what you have prepared, what's coming for those who love you. And so we seek to live in a way that honors you in all that we do. I pray for some here today that have never received Jesus Christ as their Savior. I pray that they that believe upon you, knowing that what you did on the cross and in your burial and your resurrection was sufficient payment for their salvation, if they would but trust in you. Help them know by your Spirit's teaching and working today that they are to trust in you. And we as Christians, may we look forward to that day, Heaven's Awards Day, and how we live on this day for your honor and glory in Jesus' name. Amen. Stand with me as we sing.
I when will the moment come when I shall lay my armor by and dwell in peace at home? We'll work till Jesus comes. We'll work till Jesus comes. We'll work till Jesus comes, and we'll be gathered. Christ, I fled for rest, He bade me cease to roam, and lean for comfort on His breast till He conducts me home. We'll work till Jesus comes, we'll work till Jesus comes, we'll work till Jesus comes, and we'll be gathered home.
We're going to work, and we'll work with joy and gladness in serving Him. Glad you're here this morning. Hope you'll be back Wednesday night as we continue our study in the book of Mark. Let's sing our closing song. We'll work.
And we'll work till Jesus comes. We'll work till Jesus comes,
we'll work
till Jesus comes, and we'll be gathered home.
Thank you for being here today. We hope to see you Wednesday night.